Supporters of the Robinhood tax are finally being heard. Minnesota Congressman Keith Ellison introduced a bill last month that would charge 0.5% on financial transactions. If passed, the bill would generate $350 billion in revenue each year.
The money is in the hands of the most privileged and well-to-do Americans, many of whom churn, and I don't say trade, I mean churn, stocks, bonds, and derivatives on Wall Street. So one of the ways for us as Americans to recoup the money is to tax them when they do these churning of these financial assets.
One of the biggest supporters of the tax has been the union National Nurses United. Ken Zinn is the political director for the group. He says the Robinhood tax would go to fund social programs in education and health care, which suffered severe cuts due to the recession.
The fact of the matter is that what we really need is this money to be used to meet human needs. The deficit is not something that this is intended for. It's really intended to take care of the communities across the country that are suffering so badly. About 4 years ago, Congress bailed out Wall Street to the tune of hundreds of billions of dollars, and that money has not found its way to Main Street. We think it's time that Main Street got bailed out.
The Robinhood tax has gained celebrity endorsements from the likes of Chris Martin of Coldplay, billionaire philanthropist Bill Gates, and economist Jeffrey Sachs. In this promotional video, you can see actor Mark Ruffalo drawing on a dollar bill, a Robinhood disguise, on the first president of the United States, George Washington. This has become a signature of the movement.
It's time to pass the Robinhood tax.
Even fiscal conservatives like German Chancellor Angela Merkel agree on instituting a financial transaction tax. And on October 7th, at a meeting between European Union finance ministers, 11 EU countries voted in favor of coordinating the implementation of a financial transaction tax. The list includes Austria, Belgium, Estonia, France, Germany, Greece, Italy, Portugal, Slovakia, Slovenia, and Spain. Other countries could opt in to join as well. But there are critics who see the Robinhood tax as potentially hurting the U.S. economy further, especially pension holders. Georgetown University economics professor James Angel says financial firms would pass off the cost of the tax to consumers.
If you look at, you know, where a transaction tax winds up, it basically ends up boomeranging to the, you know, the investors at the end of the day. You know, so your mutual fund, your retirement plan, you know, that's what's going to end up paying the tax. And if you look at you know, how it's going to drive up costs for investors, it and the impact on the economy, well, then you have to say, well, is this a tax which is going to cost more than it raises?
But for co-director of the UMass Amherst Political and Economic Research Institute, Bob Polin, it's clear who will be taxed under this law.
The people who pay the tax are just like you and me buying a stick of chewing gum. It's the people on Wall Street who are trading. They pay the tax. Now, is it possible that they will attempt to pass on the tax by raising their fees to their clients or by seeing the price of stocks go up, the transaction costs? Yes, that's possible. How much will it occur? We don't know. Professor Angel doesn't know this. There isn't research which tells us this. I've been over this with him before. There isn't research which tells us the extent to which the pass-through to somebody else is going to take place. Of course, as Professor Angel knows full well, there is competition in the financial markets. And so are the people doing the transactions, are they going to automatically pass on their costs to the final consumers, to the, say, the pensioners? Well, they would like to, but then that means that the rate of return that the pensioners get is going to have to go down, so that in a competitive situation, a pension fund that is forced to pay these taxes is going to try to make it up some other way. in the end, the impact, we know the impact is going to be directly on the people doing the trading.
Poland argues that there isn't research to quantify the actual impact of the tax on the U.S. financial markets. But when you look overseas, financial markets in South Korea and the United Kingdom, where the 0.5% financial transaction tax exists, markets are still functioning.
We do know that in the UK, the market is doing just fine in the sense that there's a lot of trading going on with the tax. The traders are absorbing the tax, or the traders are attempting to pass on the tax. I'm sure they are attempting to pass on the tax. We don't know how much they're doing. What we do know is that the market is functioning fine.
In the UK, the financial transaction tax raises $4 billion annually in additional revenue. And the London Stock Exchange still remains the trading capital of Europe. But Professor Angel says that based on a report by the European Commission, economists found that the impact in gross domestic product was comparable in size to the amount of revenue being collected.
Now, one of the first principles of taxation is you don't want to be doing so much damage to the economy that it costs more to collect the tax than you actually gain from the revenue. We've got plenty of other taxes that are easier to collect and do not have the same depressing effect on the economy. What you do, and the reason why it would have a depressing effect on the economy, is you make it more expensive for people to invest. That means their return is lower. That means that they're going to invest less. That means it's going to cost companies more to raise the capital they need to expand. That means they're going to raise less capital, they're going to invest less in economic growth, and that leads to fewer jobs.
But Poland disagrees, rebutting that even if there is a decline in hyper-speculative trading, the hundreds of billions of dollars raised will be positive for the economy, not negative.
Right. Assume the trading goes down by 50%. So part of the point of this tax is actually to discourage excessive hyper-speculative trading. So I'm assuming that the market adjusts, there will be less trading because people don't want to pay the tax. So I'm assuming the tax discourages excessive trading, and even with discouraging excessive trading to the extent of 50%, the markets contract by 50%, we still can show how you can raise somewhere in the range of $300 billion per year, which would be extremely important for meeting social needs in this country and for long-term deficit reduction.
But Professor Angel says if the driving factor in issuing the tax is to act as some sort of retribution for Wall Street's waywardness in causing the recession, the tax should hit profits directly.
Yeah. I mean, if the goal is to stick it to the fat cats, if the goal is to stick it to Wall Street, you should tax profits directly. Okay. That would be a much simpler way to do it.
We want to tax trading whether or not there's a profit. See, the financial transaction tax doesn't bother with whether or not there's a profit as a result of the trade. It's the trading itself. As a consequence, it is a much simpler tax. It is a tax strictly on the trade. Now, do we know when there's going to be a profit? How do we measure the profit? All of these get into more complicated accounting issues that aren't going to get settled until the end of the year. In this case, what we are doing is taxing exactly at the point of the simple activity of a trade. We have a tax rate. It doesn't matter whether or not you profit, you pay the tax.
The United States is not new to the idea of a financial transaction tax. It came into effect under Woodrow Wilson's administration in 1914 and then evolved and began to tax the market value of each stock. But in 1965, Congress voted it out with the general view that it complicated securities transactions. Professor Angel argues that tax history would repeat itself.
Now, 1965 was right when the Vietnam War was heating up. And if you go back and read the congressional debate on this, they were well aware of the fact the government needed money for the Vietnam War, but they also realized that it was a stupid tax.
Professor Poland says that this version of the tax is not complicated at all, but simple.
The basic concept is no more complicated than if I go to buy a pack of chewing gum and pay a 6% sales tax. In this case, if I go to buy a share of a stock, I pay a 0.5% tax. So the basic concept could not be more simple. Now, what makes it complicated, what really makes it complicated, is, of course, the efforts by Wall Street lawyers and the like to add all kinds of exceptions. And when you start adding exceptions, of course, you get hundreds of pages of legal documents, and then you get hundreds of more pages of lawyers trying to figure out why their clients should be exempt. So the simplest way to operate the tax is to do it without exemptions, that it applies across the board. Just get used to it. If you want to trade on Wall Street, you're going to pay this small tax.
The Robinhood tax bill brought forth by Representative Ellison is not the first of its kind. Last November, Democratic Representatives Peter DeFazio of Oregon and Senator Tom Harkin, an Iowa Democrat, proposed a tax that only called for a 0.03% financial tax. That would mean that for every $1,000 in transactions, they would collect 30 cents. By contrast, in Ellison's bill, for every $1,000 in transactions, the government would collect $5. The DeFazio measure still remains in the Senate Committee on Finance. A similar fate could await Congressman Ellison's bill if it fails to muster up enough support on the Hill. Currently, the bill has only 10 co-sponsors. The Republican-controlled House does not look like it will be changing hands in November, with Democrats trailing by 25 seats. And being in the majority means Republicans will control what is put to a vote on the House floor. But organizations like National Nurses United plan to continue their fight by holding rallies or sit-ins in congressmen's offices, whatever it takes to spread the word. Poland emphasizes that people must exercise their voice to see this bill become a reality.
The political process, policymakers to set the rules by which anybody can operate. I will assume that each and every trader is going to do things to make as much money for him or herself within the rules of the game. Yes, you will have a few outliers that'll try to break the rules, but most people will operate within the rules that are set down. The problem is that the politicians deregulated the financial market and allowed this irresponsible behavior, unsocial behavior, socially destructive behavior to consume Wall Street. And in turn, by consuming Wall Street, consuming the entire global financial market.
A strong message for those on Main Street looking for Wall Street to take some economic responsibility. For the Real News Network, Jessica Devereaux, Washington.